Okay, welcome everyone. My name's Christoph. This is Nikhita. We are the technical leads for the Contributor Experience Special Interest Group. Today we are going to do a deep dive into some of the more interesting, somewhat technical, somewhat thorny issues that we deal with in Contributor Experience and how we work through automation, through scripts, through tooling to improve the experience of anybody who's contributing to Kubernetes across the board, and to make the lives of contributors, leaders, SIG chairs, how we make their lives easier in the project. Before we get started, just like a very brief touch on, I don't know if everyone here knows what contributor experience does. So our goal within Kubernetes, as I said, is to improve what the experience that contributors have when they start from somebody brand new to the project to somebody who's very experienced, making sure that every time they touch a GitHub repo, every time they're talking in Slack, communicating on Zoom, that their experience is a positive one, that they have the tools they need, that they have the data they need to make smart decisions and have a positive impact on the project. With the size and velocity of Kubernetes, a lot of this work and automation is imperative because otherwise we just would not be able to scale. While there are big numbers that are thrown around, like 35,000 total contributors to the project, there's still a very tight core of people who are there on a daily basis, who are like the sub-project owners, the approvers, the SIG leads, the folks that basically have to wrangle all of these 35,000 people in the same direction and contributing to the project. So that's kind of where we come in. We handle both human interactions, so things like mentoring programs, as well as technical tools and automation to make folks' lives easier. So specifically today, we're going to be focusing on some technical issues and some of the thought processes that go into when we're thinking about tools, when we're thinking about automation, when we're thinking about how we're improving that experience for both new and like very experienced contributors. What kind of stuff goes into that thought process? Because some of it seems fairly straightforward, but some of it, as soon as you like pull things apart, gets a little bit thorny. And the call to action from this is hopefully, if you have never picked up an issue in contributor experience before, or you are interested in some of that automation, if you're interested in like the process flow of how we go about making a change to our community tooling or community process for a community this large, hopefully you'll be engaged. Maybe you'll pick up one of these issues and help us out with it, or find something else very similar, but have a little bit, have the background needed to be able to jump in.
Cool. So not used to MacBook. Do we require to be larger? Okay, perfect. So we're gonna go through some easy and good first issues first so that you can start out with these issues if you want to like get involved in SIG contributor experience, and if you want to get involved in some technical aspects in SIG contributor experience, which you've never done before. So the first issue that we're going to talk about is the need SIG issue. So in the Kubernetes repo, when I say Kubernetes, it means the GitHub repo, github.com/Kubernetes/Kubernetes, the main Kubernetes repo. So in that repo, whenever someone creates an issue, we require that the issue has a SIG label. So a SIG label can look something like SIG/node, SIG/API machinery, SIG/CLI. We require that because it makes it easier for SIGs to triage issues, because or else it's definitely going to get lost in like more than 2,000 issues that we have. And whenever an issue does not have a SIG label, we automatically add a needs SIG label, and the bot also adds a comment. And the comment says something like, there are no SIG labels on this issue. If you want to add a SIG label, you can do two things. The first thing is that you can mention a GitHub team for that SIG. So it can look something like at Kubernetes/SIG contributor experience PR reviews or SIG contributor experience bugs. I think that's the team. And when you mention at mention a team, it automatically has a SIG contributor experience label, and the need SIG label goes away. The other way that you can remove the need SIG label is by saying slash SIG on the SIG's name, so slash SIG contributor experience or slash SIG CLI. Now we want to change this workflow a little bit, because the first way of at mentioning a GitHub team just leads to so many notifications for people, and I sometimes ignore these notifications, team notifications. I know lots of other people do as well. And it just does not help, because sometimes people also think that it belongs to a particular SIG, but it really doesn't, and ends up notifying lots of people. So we want to avoid that. So what do we do here? The solution to this would be to update, so the bot adds this comment. So there is like a string in, so we have a tool called Prow in Test Infra. Alvar over there did a deep dive on it, so you should watch his talk if you wanna get much more information about Prow. So you're gonna edit this comment and just remove the first part about at mentioning a GitHub team. So you just keep the part about using the slash labels. The way we work in the Kubernetes community when we make such big changes that touches the whole organization, the whole GitHub organization and the whole community, is something called as lazy consensus. Because we want everyone, like if anyone has objections to that, they should be able to voice it out. And we usually use a three days lazy consensus time period. So lazy consensus means that you send out a note to the mailing list that says, hey, we're making this change. If anyone has objections, please raise these objections before this date. And if there are no objections by then, we merge the PR. So the next steps in this would be open a PR against the test info repo to remove that string, talk to SIG contribex people, get reviews on that PR, and then send an email to the mailing list, which has a lazy consensus time period of 3 days or so, get consensus, and merge the PR. So it's a good first issue. If you want to jump in and, like, if you're completely new to all of this, you can also, like, ask questions in SIG contribex on Slack. We're very friendly. You can also reach out to us now after this talk, and we can help you out with that. So, yeah, that's about this issue.
The next one we're going to talk about is a markdown linter for our org. So inside of our organization, we have a lot of markdown in a lot of different places. In particular, the community repo has a lot of markdown documentation in both our contributor guide, our developer guide. It has a lot of how-tos on doing specific things like bumping Go modules in the main Kubernetes repo. So there's all this documentation and all these things, but the documentation is inconsistent. We don't have, like, not everything uses the same like indentation on certain things. It's very loose. So this was a problem kind of across the board. We didn't have a great solution, but one of our contributors in cluster API provider vSphere, Andrew here, he looked into some tools to kind of solve this for specifically cluster API provider vSphere, and he was able to kind of resolve it for them. There's a tool that he was able to pick out that does markdown linting, and the format that it was able to do it in. You're able to have a configuration file at the root of the repository that sets these are the particular lints that we want to turn on, that we want to enforce. And so that, like, if a particular repository actually has a slightly different standard, but they want to enforce consistency among that repo, that those standards can be set in the repo, and then we can template out a pre-submit job, which in Prow is a piece of CI that runs prior to your PR being merged. So it's a sanity check that the change that you're making to our repo actually conforms with our standards. So this particular pre-submit, this particular linter, right now we have all the puzzle pieces together that we could set up, okay, here's the template, here's kind of what our default standard is, here's how you would go and modify that linter configuration for your repo, and offer options to other repos to use the work that the cluster API provider API vSphere folks have already kind of put together and turned on theirs. So the next steps on something like this, there isn't any code to write because it's kind of already been solved. But what it does need is a champion to go and collect all those pieces together, look at all the settings that they have turned on and they've got linked to, be able to submit pull requests, again, to our test infrastructure repository and say, we want to turn this example, we want to turn this on for the community repo now, and test out there, because that's where a lot of our documentation is, and then document what that process looks like step by step by step. Because then we can take that documentation of, oh, you would like a markdown linter turned on for your repo to enforce some standards. Here's the document. Here's what you go do. Here's the job that you can basically copy and paste into your repo, and you're done, and you're off to the races. So this is another kind of like good first issue in that it doesn't require any prior knowledge. It doesn't require any special skills. It doesn't require knowledge of a specific programming language or even a specific Kubernetes standard. But it requires a champion with a bit of time to say, like, okay, I'm going to own this, I'm going to carry it through to the end, and I'm going to do the steps needed to collect all these pieces together, file the necessary PRs, achieve lazy consensus. That would be another step, as Nikhita mentioned, for a lot of these changes, just notifying, we intend to make this change. Does anybody have any issues with that? And then roll it out first to our community repo, and then document that process so that everybody can benefit from that change.
Cool. So next, we will move on to some medium issues. They're not good first issues, but they are issues that you would, if you want to work on, that they're a little largely scoped. It requires a little more technical background, but it's a little harder than the good first issues. Let's just leave it at that. So the first issue that we're going to be looking at is about automation does not remove repo collaborators. So how many of you are audit Kubernetes GitHub org members here, Kubernetes SIGs? Okay. So you probably know a little bit about this. So to give a brief background, we have more than 1,000 members in our Kubernetes GitHub org right now. And if we want to add a new member, we don't want someone who is an admin on the Kubernetes GitHub org to like go add them through the UI, because that's just painful. It also does not leave a log of why they were added or why someone was removed or what's going on in the whole picture. So we built a tool for it, which uses, surprise, YAML, that helps manage the GitHub repo configuration. It's called Peribolas. What is Peribolas? It's a Greek term for?
It's a Greek term for a walled garden.
Okay, it's a Greek term for a walled garden. So it's called Peribolas. We have weird names. It's called Peribolas. And what it does is that we have a YAML file which says, these are the members. We have a YAML file with GitHub usernames of all members in the GitHub org. And if you want to add someone, you just add their name to the YAML file. If you want to remove someone from the org, you just remove it. And we have, and this tool syncs the actual GitHub organization configuration with this YAML file. So if you add someone, they get added in the org, and if you remove someone, they get removed here. And whenever you add someone to the GitHub org, a bot sends an invitation email to the person who's getting added. So there are a few things that Parabolas also does, is that it also like helps manage team configurations and organization memberships and admins in an organization. What it does not do right now is that it does not help manage repo collaborators. So GitHub allows you to add outside collaborators to a particular repo. They don't need to be org members, and any repo admin can add them. And you can give them any access. Like, you can add a random person to a repo if you have admin access to that repo, and you can give them admin access or write access. And that's just dangerous, because admin access allows you to delete repos and do really crazy stuff. So we want to avoid that. And we want to build this functionality in Parabolas to help manage repo collaborators. So that's what this issue is about. There is some prior art that, I worked on a PR that helps manage this, but it got stalled for various reasons. If you're interested, you can like pick up on that PR. There is also a comment which has more information about the way the config would look like. So the next steps here would be to get flesh out how the config would look like before starting to write the code, because it can just get really messy and you'll have to make lots of changes later. So it would look something like this. This is just a brief. It might not look exactly like this. So like, we have the Kubernetes org, and we have the test infra repo. Test infra admins, GitHub team should have admin access on that repo. Test infra maintainers should have write access. So maintainers is the term that we use for giving write access. They should have write access on that repo, and Fippy, Goldie, and Captain Cube are the outside collaborators. We could also update this to make sure that we also use a configuration to document what permissions Fippy has, or Goldie has, or Captain Cube has. That'd be really nice. So the next step here would be to make sure that we decide the configuration of how it should look like. Then also figure out if we want to use the GitHub v4 API for this, because v3 is, well, let's just say v4 is way better than v3. And then writing the code for it. Since there is prior art, you can pick up on that and reach out to us like if you have questions about this, and the test infra testing folks as well. We also want to probably remove all outside collaborators at one go sometimes. Because there are outside collaborators right now, and we want to clean them up and start afresh. So maybe, I'm not sure, like maybe we'll need to flesh it out in a design. Maybe we could add a flag like remove outside collaborators, which removes them all in one go. So something like that, we could flesh them out, discuss in meetings, and write a design, and then write code for it. So yeah, if you have questions, again, find us later.
I think that's probably the golden rule for anything that we're talking about right now. Like, is like a lot of these things will involve a little bit of discussion, a little bit of back and forth. That's how we kind of classify issues. Like, when we try and label something a good first issue, it's we've had all the discussions, we kind of know what we want to do, but we just need somebody to like pick up the torch and do the work. As we start moving into these medium issues and the more thorny, difficult ones, we have a very, very rough idea of where we want to go and what we want to do, but it involves discussions, it involves achieving consensus, it involves hashing out a particular design. So like there's some extra steps that again, just kind of need a champion to pick up the torch and run with it. So moving on. So this is a more recent one. So warrant of a PR has kind deprecation, but no release note. So kind deprecation is a fairly new label that was added. We wanted to be able to call out, in particular with the Kubernetes core repo, but also for across our sub-project, when a PR is deprecating a particular functionality. The reason for that is Kubernetes has a formal deprecation policy that must be adhered to. So there's, in addition to just merging code that is sane and functional and works, we also need to make sure that the PR follows the deprecation policy and that the folks in charge of our release team are also aware that this particular PR will be impactful because and should be called out as a separate line item as that release will deprecate or start a deprecation process for a particular feature. So we added this new label, but right now, that's all it is. It's just a label that gets thrown on something. There isn't any extra automation behind the label to kind of enforce our policies. So one policy that we're looking at adding here is if a PR has the kind deprecation label, I'm just gonna scroll down because we just recently talked about this and I wanted to write down kind of the way we're thinking of taking this design. So if a PR has kind deprecation and has release note none, so this means that the author of the PR has specified that this particular PR does not need a release note. If we have that combination of labels on a PR, that's invalid and the bot should fix that. So that will be dropping release note none, adding do not merge release note needed, and add a note to the PR of why we made that change, why that combination of the two settings is invalid. So this would prompt the PR author to then revisit like, oh, I shouldn't say release note none. I should actually put in a release note describing what this change is actually doing. And the do not merge class label will stay on the PR until that they've done that. And that will prevent Tide, which is our automated merge robot. It'll prevent Tide from merging the PR into the repo. So this extra step here make sure that it takes a human out from doing this. Right now, that's what we have, is an extra line item on a human reviewer to make sure that when they're reviewing the PR, when they're giving their approvals, that, okay, this is a deprecation, it absolutely needs a release note. In most cases, we've done this, and this is fine, like having a human do this, but the more things that we can take off of a human's mind, that they can focus on the quality of the code, the functionality, and knowing that we have bots enforcing these policies around a particular thing. And this also means that maybe not necessarily like the approver to the PR, but anyone from the release team can add, oh, I see that this is a deprecation. I'm just gonna add kind deprecation on there. And that means that this PR will not merge unless it has a proper release note describing the deprecation. It's just one of those extra niceties where a bot will enforce our policies as opposed to having every specific reviewer checking for this long list of policies and allowing them to focus on the quality of the code, what's being done, speeding up the time. Because this also means that like a lot of reviewers, if they know that there's already like a do not merge label on it, a lot of reviewers will just be like, oh, I can scroll, a bot's already taken care of it. I don't need to like re-review or figure out why something's not merging. This prompts the author to do it before the reviewer even gets to the PR. So that when the reviewer does have the time to review it, they can also review the contents release note, make sure that it makes sense. Just one of those things to improve the lives. Like this one is not necessarily for PR authors. This does help them. PR authors would have to do this anyways, But this is more focused on helping our reviewers and our approvers focus on what they need to do best and helping us scale humans.
Issues.
Okay. So this is a long-standing one.
It's like a two-year anniversary.
Yeah. Something like that. You will be officially my best friend if you pick this up and you help me with this. Before I go into the details of this specific issue, I want to pause for a second. I want to talk about owner's files. You may or may not have been exposed to owner's files and what they do and what they mean to our organization. So again, we have 35,000 plus contributors, and we need a way of scaling out folks to review and approve all of those PRs. And we need to be able to split apart our core Kubernetes repo is a monolith and has a whole bunch of different code for a whole bunch of different components. And those components, there are very few people in this organization that can say they truly know every single component and they keep up with all of those changes. So we actually have split apart the different parts of the code base and delegate authority out to individual approvers, individual owners for subcomponents of Kubernetes. So maybe you're really interested in networking and you want to focus in on kubeproxy. Or maybe you're interested in how Kubernetes interacts with different cloud providers. You want to focus in on the cloud controller manager. The different components allow, or the different subdirectories within Kubernetes get split out, and they have in them these files that are just called owners, all in caps. Those owners contain lists of who is allowed to review things in this directory, and who is authorized as an approver, as an owner, to sign off on changes that are done to files in that directory. This has worked very well for us. However, there are times when there are specific files or specific processes that we can't split out and have, that we can't put things in separate directories for typically technical reasons that we can't just distribute things. One example of this is in the main Kubernetes repo. Because it's a Go application, it has a Go mod and a Go sum file in the root of that repo, and it has to sit in the root of that repo, which means that to modify those files, you need sign off from a root level approver, which is a very small number of people who are very oversubscribed. So we can't delegate authority out without, right now, those files need those root level approvers. We have actually gone in like about 2 years ago, we redid a library we have in our test info repo called Repo Owners, which describes what those owner files look like and the different functionalities in them. That Repo Owners library was set up that we can now use regex filtering and have, so within a directory, say, Go mod and Go sum, they can have a slightly different set of reviewers and approvers than every other file in the directory. There are different plugins in Prowl that consume that data and can use those regex filters to do things right now, like labeling things. So if it's touching Go mod or Go sum, label that file as a dependency change, because we know it's affecting our vendored dependencies for Kubernetes. However, the approve plugin, as one of the oldest plugins that consumes repo owners and consumes owners files, it currently doesn't have that functionality, isn't capable of using that functionality because it makes a whole bunch of assumptions about how owners files are used. One of those assumptions is if you have approve rights, you have approve rights over the whole directory. So we can't do something like, oh, you have approved writes on just these two files, but not everything else. So maybe if you change go mod or go sum, you should be able to do that, but if you're trying to change like readme.md in the core of Kubernetes, you're not supposed to do that. You need somebody else to sign off on that. Another very common example is right now all of our release notes or change logs are in the root of Kubernetes. And it would be great to be able to delegate out to folks like our release team to manage those change logs without needing that oversubscribed level of root approvers to fix a spelling error in a change log. But right now, that's our reality because of the assumptions that approve makes. Multiple people have attempted this. And multiple people have found out that like the plugin as it is very, like it's difficult to break it apart. This one almost needs a champion. This is why it's kind of in our thorny category. This one really needs a champion to go and first take a look at all of our tests, our unit tests for approve, and make sure that we have the right tests, testing the right use cases, and abstracting those a bit away from the code that they're doing. Because if we have a proper test suite, we could then go and completely rewrite approve and have not necessarily start from a legacy code base on a plugin that's many years old. We could go and rewrite it from the ground up, wiping away those assumptions around individual directories. You can only lump it this way. Because it's not just code. There's also actually like the user interface for this plugin. When this plugin replies back, it's one of the most every PR you will see this plugin talking to you because it's going to tell you if this PR is approved, if it's not, and which approvers you need to go and seek out. And there's also algorithms inside that figure out who's the best person to get to approve this. Somebody who hopefully is not oversubscribed because the plugin could just be stupid and suggest like, oh, these five people in the root file, just get them to approve everything. And then no PRs would be merged ever because those people would have 1,000 PR long queues. We want to get the right people assigned who have authority over the directories, who have authority over the code, to be able to distribute that workload evenly. So this is one that like people have attempted this. And in particular, the design pieces are the tough ones. We really don't want a major functionality change in approvers. Approvers, like, it works. The regex filtering in repo owners, that is also already done. But it's more about designing the UX for the plugin, like the messages, how those messages update, and also comes down to making sure that our testing around this plugin is proper so that when we go and swap out, like, approve V2, we know that we're not going to break people, because again, this is touching literally every PR across all of our 200-plus repos in the Kubernetes project. So this is one that's like super critical, super important. It would allow us, it would unlock a lot of doors, but it's going to take time. It's going to take time, and there's definitely time from like the folks that have written different plugins for Prowl, from like Nikhita and myself, who are technical leads. Like, we definitely have time to help mentor, but digging into all those little code bits and digging into all those tests, unfortunately, we're oversubscribed, just like everybody else. So this is definitely one that I would love if somebody would come up and say, I'm going to tackle approve. That would make me very happy. And that's why I want to talk about this, because it also comes down to the thought process behind it. It's not just code. It's about the entire experience that we're trying to give people. And we don't want to swap out approve for something that is going to impact the velocity of the rest of the project. We're trying to rewrite this or fix this with regex so that we're improving that velocity and we're maintaining the algorithms that we have around approver selection.
Cool. Do we have time left?
Yes. No. I'm not sure.
I'm just gonna like quickly mention the other issue that we have. if I can get this thing working. Okay. So Christoph mentioned about owner's files, and owner's files have reviewers and approvers mentioned in those owner's files. So reviewers are the folks who are going to review the PR, and the bot automatically suggests two reviewers whenever someone opens a new PR. So how do these reviewers get added? What the ideal scenario would be that approvers look at who is reviewing the PRs, and then they add these new folks into the owner's files. Sometimes it doesn't work out that way. So most folks generally PR themselves in. They open a PR to add themselves into an owner's file. But I know that sometimes I feel shy doing that because I'm not sure if I'm like qualified to be a reviewer. And I find it weird opening a PR to add myself in, or even just to ask someone, like, is it OK? What if they say no? To tackle all of these social problems, and especially sustainability, because if people don't step up to be reviewers, we have like a stale list of reviewers in owner's files, then PRs are just not going to get reviewed. And we kind of see this problem already happening in Kubernetes. To tackle this problem, we want to build a tool that automatically suggests reviewers for a particular file or a particular directory. So the way we would do this, so GitHub, the GitHub API has all of this information. So the way we would do this is when you look at the GitHub API and when you look at a PR, the API can tell you who authored the PR or who reviewed the PR and what files the PR touches. So the idea is to use a GitHub API to look at the PR and the files that it touches in a certain period of time. So who reviewed this PRs touching this file in the last 1 year, in the last 6 months? We want that kind of information. So we would use the API to look at who authored this PR, who reviewed it, how many did they review, how many PRs were they requested review upon, and how many did they actually review. Things like that. Statistics around that would help us to automatically suggest reviewers to SIG leads or subproject owners or approvers in owners' files and help us improve the social problems around it. We also have another tool called DevStats. I think it's kates.devstats.cncf.io, which gives you a list of people and the number of contributions they've made. So that can also be helpful in figuring out. We currently don't have like information about what part of the code base they're contributing to, but we can probably get that information as well from DevStats. So we would need a design over here first. Once we get the design up and running, we can write a tool for it. Writing the design would involve looking at the GitHub API, what information we can get from it, and maybe also checking if we can leverage DevStats for getting this information. And yeah, like once you get the design up and running, you can write the tool, and we can use that. We're very short on time, I guess.
I think we've run a little bit over, so I don't think we have time for questions. But if you are interested in what we're doing, please come talk to us, either here or SIG ContribX in the Kubernetes Slack. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to engage with you. Even if these, like, if you would like to work on something similar to these, if you have a different idea about how to approach it, please come talk to us. We really need the help. Thank you so much.